Your doorbell rings, and there stands a little boy with a sheet over his head, pretending to be a ghost and holding out a little bag for candy. Should Christians celebrate Halloween? Is it a harmless holiday? Or is it a nod to the occult? No matter where you stand on that question, there is something we can all celebrate this season. 5 centuries ago, a monk approached a door, not to knock, but to nail a piece of parchment to it that would change the world forever. As the Middle Ages drew to an end, the churches of Europe had come to rely on rituals, ceremonies, and works to justify men before God. The papacy increasingly promoted this approach to salvation, and as a result, grew in wealth and power. But by the early 1500s, many were beginning to question the authority of the church. The most controversial was a young German monk named Martin Luther. Now, for much of his life, Martin had struggled with his own guilt-ridden conscience, and as a young man, several events close to him reminded him not only of the imminence of his own death, but the dreadful reality of God's wrath. The death of a good friend in a student brawl, accidentally severing an artery in his leg with his own sword, not to mention a terrifying thunderstorm that brought lightning crashing down all around him. For Luther, events in this world, as well as even thinking about the next, were terrifying. And eventually, Martin sought peace with God in an Augustinian monastery. There, he obeyed the monastery's rules to the letter, diligently giving himself to prayer, fasting, and confession. And there, he had his appointed list of things to do. But the troubled young monk went further, much further, often bludgeoning and whipping himself to the point of unconsciousness. Despite all this, Martin found no peace with God. But fortunately, for the sake of the church, God was not done with this young monk, who eventually turned university professor. And so it was, as professor of moral theology in 1516, while preparing his lectures on Romans for his students at Wittenberg, that Martin discovered the doctrine of grace and forgiveness that finally brought him peace and assurance. He read in Romans, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith." Now previously, the very thought of God's justice and righteousness had terrified Martin. But through his studies, he came to understand that the righteousness of God in this passage isn't limited to the justice and holiness of God that only condemns, but it is this righteousness of Christ and his perfect obedience to God's law imputed to unworthy sinners that saves us. For Luther, he finally found what his heart so desperately needed, and with it, pure joy and assured comfort. But there's more to the Reformation story, much more. In 1517, he was now lecturing on Galatians, and it was in this epistle that became Luther's Damascus Road, because Galatians emphasized the separation of works from faith. And for Luther, the implications were enormous. Any attempts to combine works with faith as a way of justification before God was a different gospel, a false gospel. This, for Martin Luther, was an epiphany that would profoundly affect his worldview for the rest of his life, so much so that he called Galatians his book and claimed to be wed to it. In fact, he said, "The epistle to the Galatians is my epistle to which I am betrothed. It is my Katie von Bora." And it was in these lectures on Galatians that he came to understand that the ceremonial law, with all of its rituals and Jewish obligations, were only rudiments that pointed to Christ. They could never make him right with God. Rather, now that faith has come, God freely offers sinners righteousness and forgiveness through Jesus Christ. What Martin had to do, what anyone has to do, is to cling to the promises of God made to us through Jesus Christ. It was this change in worldview that gave him eyes to see the issue of indulgences more clearly. And it was here that Luther drew a line in the sand and said enough. Because like the foolish Galatians in Paul's day, Luther saw indulgences as adding to and therefore interfering with the gospel. Remember, indulgences here were offered by the church as a way of escaping God's wrath, by escaping the implications of sin, at least for a time. And for many simple peasants, it seemed more than the bargain of a lifetime, since it was an after-lifetime bargain too. And as you might expect, the sale of indulgences became big business. At the time, Dominican friar Johann Tetzel was commissioned to sell special indulgences on behalf of Pope Leo throughout all Germany, raising money ostensibly to rebuild St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. But the talented Tetzel caused quite a stir by selling indulgences not only to living customers, but claiming that his indulgences could instantly free the souls of loved ones who were suffering in purgatory. You see, Tetzel's indulgences required no penitence, only money, and he underscored their power with his own little jingle, "As soon as the coin in the coffer rings, a soul from purgatory springs." Now, unfortunately for Tetzel, his sales route brought him near Wittenberg, and when Luther discovered that members of his own congregation had bought indulgences from Tetzel, his anger moved him to pastoral action. For Luther, Tetzel had crossed the line. In response, Luther began penning his 95 Theses for Debate, aimed at the abuse of these indulgences. He then nailed these 95 Theses to the door of the Castle Church in Wittenberg on October 31st, 1517. The next day, being All Saints' Day, would draw large crowds in pilgrimage to Wittenberg to see Frederick the Wise's massive collections of relics. Martin had hoped that during the pilgrimage, a fellow theologian would pick up his challenge and engage him in the dispute. But it didn't happen the way he had imagined. The response instead was beyond his wildest expectations. In fact, what happened next would change the world forever. His protest, his 95 Theses, in today's vernacular, went viral. Printers and scholars across Germany translated, reprinted, and circulated Martin's 95 Theses. The word was out, and within weeks, the flow of money into Rome's coffers had slowed to a trickle. But the papacy didn't sit still. They attempted to bring this wild boar, as they called Luther, back to obedience. But because so many theological issues are interconnected, each of Luther's doctrinal issues led to more complications and more confrontations with Rome. Questions about salvation led to questions about church authority. After all, how do we really know what God has said in Scripture? Who or what is our final authority? The exchange between Rome and this young rogue monk grew bitter. And when Luther was finally summoned to stand before the Holy Roman Emperor, Charles V, at the Diet of Worms, he delivered his own answer to infallibility and church authority in unforgettable terms. "Unless I am convinced by Scripture and plain reason, I do not accept the authority of popes and councils, for they have contradicted each other. My conscience is captive to the Word of God. I cannot and I will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. God help me. Amen." You see, Luther believed that a man of faith with his Bible in hand could stand against popes and emperors and declare, "Thus saith the Lord." This was the Reformation that shattered the old hierarchies and brought down the oppressive bureaucracies and reasserted the freedom of the believer under God. And let's also remember that when the just live and walk by faith, it's more than a religious doctrine. The psychological and social implications were then and continue to be profound. First, the justified man is free, free from guilt and without the need to practice self-atonement. That means the end of drunkenness, depravity, any addictions or perversities used to drown out or sear a guilty conscience. Second, the believer is free from human mediators. While still respecting God's given authority, the believer knows that no human can manipulate or control his access to God. Instead, Luther emphasized the priesthood of all believers. And third, as a priest, the believer has no need to make his life or his vocation holy by adding religious trappings. He is holy in Christ, and his work and calling, therefore, are a form of worship. That means that any and all work done faithfully and humbly is serving God just as faithfully as those working inside the church. Fourth, the believer can face the world with confidence, knowing that he's accepted by God. He can live in optimism and hope, bold before God and fearless before men. This was Luther's Reformation, or perhaps more accurately stated, this was God's Reformation, a movement that God would use to reform hearts, homes, minds, and culture across Europe, America, and the entire world. That's why we should remember the Reformation and teach Reformation history to our kids and grandkids. And it's also why each and every one of us should examine our own hearts and ask ourselves, in the spirit of the Reformation, is there anything other than the righteousness of Christ standing between us and our Heavenly Father? I hope you can see that it was Christ alone in Paul's day that turned the world upside down. And it was Christ alone in Luther's day that shook the world so profoundly. And it remains Christ alone in our day that can once again transform hearts and minds across the globe. Remember, now that Christ, the object of our faith, has come into our lives, we need only to live by that faith. And when we do that, God promises us that the fruit of that faith will, once again, turn the world upside down.